How this all began is actually because of Raina right here. When I had her in class in her junior year, Raina got very, very angry at me one day. I had her for a class called Shaping the Modern World, and I showed a very liberal film. I was very anti-United States Army regarding the war in Iraq, right? And the one day after I showed it, I had to finish up the last 15 minutes of the next day. She came walking up to me in the hallway before class, bright red, as angry as she could possibly be. And I said, Raina, what's wrong? She said, I refuse to sit in this class today. And I said, what's the matter? What happened? And she's like, I'm not going to listen to this bleep anymore. She actually swore at me, which is kind of a first for me being a teacher. And I said, please tell me what is wrong with what's happening right now. Because she's this little sweet little quiet girl that never really would do that to me. And she said, I'm sick of this. This is disgusting. I can't believe the things that are being said in this. And I can bring in some people that can tell you the truth about the war in Iraq, who were there, who saw what happened, and tell you the truth. And I told her, please do. Please do bring those people in. So she did. She gathered up some friends, and they came in, and they did a presentation. I was just blown away, and I really enjoyed it. And I thank Raina for that, because we've been doing that ever since she brought those people in. So it's become a tradition now that I have as many troops in as I possibly can, and it's all because of Raina. So I thank Raina for that, and hopefully you enjoy their stories today. Again, all three of them are CB graduates. They got a little PowerPoint they put together for you about their experiences thus far. And I'm not going to take stage anymore. Go ahead, guys.
Alright, I'll start. Good morning, everybody. I'm Sean Cullen, her brother. I graduated in 2007, and I came here today to talk just because when I was in high school, I didn't really know about the opportunities that the military had, and I wanted to share that with you so that you guys are more prepared as you go on to your high school career. So there's a couple different commissioning programs. I'm an officer in the Navy, and there's four basic ways you can become an officer. You can go to the Naval Academy or a four-year college. It's free. But you owe the Navy, depending on what you do in the Navy, you owe either 4 or 8 years, 4, 6, or 8, depending on what you do. Pilots owe 8 years, NFOs owe 6, and service corps officers owe 4. You go to OCS, so after you go to college, you put in like an application, and you go to a 12-week officer candidate school program, and apply for what you want to do in the Navy. After that, you commission as an officer and go out there and start doing it yourself. Or you can do what I did. I did Navy ROTC. Reserve Officer Training Corps. There's a bunch of participating universities all over the country, and then they have like crosstown universities. So like if you went to like Duquesne, you could do ROTC at Pitt or whatever, like that. And then if you decide you want to enlist in the Navy, you can do a program called Seaman to Admiral. So if you enlist and you decide, you know what, I think I want to be an officer, I think I want to lead these guys, you can do the Seaman to Admiral program, and they'll send you to college, finish getting your degree, and then you're commissioned as an officer. So this is what I did. I did Navy ROTC at Embry-Riddle. I got my degree in aerospace engineering, and while I was there, I got selected as a student naval aviator. And then after that, I commissioned in December when I graduated, and then I went to Pensacola, Florida for aviation pre-flight indoctrination. It's like 6 weeks long, 4 weeks of just academics and survival swimming, and then the last 2 weeks are all survival swimming. So they put you in all your flight gear, helmet, like vest, and your weight. You have like 40 pounds of gear on, and they throw you in the pool and try and make sure you don't drown. We do another thing, it's called the helo-dunker, because a helicopter's crashing in the water, they flip upside down. So they strap you in a helicopter, throw you in the pool, and it flips upside down, and you have to be able to get out without drowning. Then, we moved to Corpus Christi, Texas, and they did primary flight training there. It's about 26 weeks long. I flew an older plane, it's called a T-34 Charlie Turbo Mentor, and they're replacing those right now. And I just finished that, and now I'm going on to intermediate flight training with VT-9 Tigers in Marine, Mississippi to fly a T-45 Mouse. So I have a couple pictures I'll show you as I went through training. This is me on my first solo, just flying around in Corpus Christi. They give me a $1 million airplane to let me go take it around and fly around by myself in like 2 hours. Next slide. This is me. I'm sitting in the front seat, my instructor's in the back. This is like more of a chair down, I think. And this is, we flew up to Nevada for cross country with another plane. And that's like Lake Mead with like the Hoover Dam and stuff. And this part of the training is formation flight training. So you need to be able to fly in formation with another aircraft. Because when you go to combat, you want to like mass your forces so you have a bunch of airplanes flying together so you can mass your forces. So we learn how to fly really close to each other while you're going really fast. So we're going like 200 miles an hour right there. And probably tough in that picture, but they're only like 15 feet apart. And And then this is what I'm going to fly next, Keeper 5 Goshawk, and I'll start landing on aircraft carriers. I have a little video. No sound, it doesn't matter, it's just an end. So this is water flying kind of like open formation on this guy. We do a small canopy roll. So you go up in there and you roll over and go on the other side.
Any questions you want.